It may be a model for a new building, new office block, or a new approach. But you can apply that same approach to an old landscape. That's what I'm advocating. But the problem is, in all these things, is how is the thinking. You know, you do all the work, and in the background is this Dr. Death, called the accountant or the quantity surveyor, who spends very little time actually adding up figures, but he knows that in the end he can knock the scheme because he doesn't have to account for the 30 gigajoules. In our whole economy, our economic system does not factor in the cost of natural resources. It doesn't factor it in. I mean, don't you agree with that? There are books written about it, but we've never actually got there. And until we do that, I don't think, you know, until it becomes part of our thinking, our culture, that we value. You know, according to New Scientist, 15 years' time, there's no copper left on the planet. Forget about oil. Did you see that those predictions of resources running out? It's absolutely appalling to think of it. The minerals will dry up very shortly at the rate at which we're using them. And that includes recycling. Because when you recycle copper, you actually lose 30%. It goes up in smoke and in entropy. So it's we have to really start rationing ourselves and our resources and using what there is. So I don't want to be downcast. I think it's very exciting, actually. I enjoy what I do, and I haven't yet persuaded people to spend a lot of money on an old building, but I will eventually, because it'll have to come. You have something to say.
Well, I was just thinking, actually, as a statistic, and casting my mind back 38 years to meadows and the limits to growth.
Well, that's what
predicting then exactly the same confident terms that by now we've run out of copper and many other things. And others replied, of course, with sort of cornucopian arguments that as price went up.
They'd find some more.
Technological efficiency went up. One could extract more. Some of which
oh, yeah.
Temporarily true.
Temporarily true,
yeah. The question is this the end to it, or is it?
Yeah.
You know, is it the end to it in 10 years or 30 years? What seems to actually be running into is the thing that Meadows didn't really talk about, which is the carrying capacity of the earth that it actually can't. It can't handle the things that we need to do to extract and use all that stuff.
Yes, yes. And what's exciting is what you can get out of plants. Mm. And then you say, well, we haven't got enough land, and so on and so on. But in fact, the molecules you can get out of plants are more complex and more useful than from fossil fuels. So, there's a great future ahead of us, and we can grow stuff on the sea, and we can do all sorts of things. But we need to start thinking that way.
We have a food crisis right now. And we've got to talk about using plants for biofuels, and that's already pushing up the price.
Absolutely, yeah. Mm. So when you start. I mean, you're going to build on a brown site, a big brown site. These are the things I think need to be faced first.
If you could use buildings as sinks for carbon sequestration, so if you actually use your plants and you made your buildings out of plants,
yeah.
Then they could become sinks. So if you got to the point, you probably wouldn't, but where it was minus 30, then it would be worth making more new buildings.
Grow your buildings.
Yes, you wouldn't grow them in situ, but you process them. I mean, where I'm from in Britain, we're building a building out of timber and hemp lime. Mm. So there's a net negative carbon for that. So the building itself will be carbon neutral. So of course, a lot of energy goes into making it, but that's also a sink as well. So I don't know how far we can carry that.
Well, I mean, in Lake Titicaca, I was thinking of the communities that grow their buildings. They're all, I've got a lovely picture of it actually in my pocket at the moment. Whole communities live on rafts of reeds, and their boats are made of reeds, and the same reeds are built their houses on, and they've been living on water for years. And water is a very good commodity to live on, because it has an immense thermal mass. You can move it, you can move your energy around very easily. You're always going to be cool, and it's a great leveler. There are other examples of that. That community must be carbon zero. It must be. In fact, it's the other way around.
Just one thing, Mick. I think what we are doing, of course, in this loose discussion, we are speaking about architecture and building and cities. Well, it is not the same thing. And I think you very justly started saying how community is what matters, politics is what matters. And in that, I always like to go back long time, to Greek origin. They used to say cities are kinonia. Kinonia is something like community, social bonds. Mm. So cities are social bonds.
Yeah.
And the word politics comes from polis, and police comes from polis.
Polis.
So it is quite obvious to me, I believe, that cities are those relations. Mm. And then, say, Henri Lefebvre or someone, he says, city is a spatial projection of society. We can be as good technicians as we want. We can know all technical solutions at our building level, but cities are not going to be sustainable because those bigger forces are pushing in an unsustainable direction.
Yeah.
Technology, economy, things like that. So I think, we are jumping scales here, but it is not only scales. I think it is very importantly issues. So I think as you started, cities as communities, cities as politics.
You could call this Ecopolis.
No, call it whatever you want, but I think it is a bit misleading to look for technical solutions for social or political problems.
Yeah.
It doesn't work, I think, that way. You have to look where the problem is, and of course we cannot resolve it, because we will be dealing in the end with some technical solutions. But there should be some carefully crafted concerns there. This works within such and such conditions. For instance, I mentioned, Chris asked about a particular Japanese situation. They face different problems. They face shrinking cities. Cities in Japan shrink because population shrinks. So different kind of problem because different kind of social, societal issues. Not lesser problems, but different.
But I mean, if you see in Zimbabwe, what drives the city building is the community and the need for this contact. And what happens is that they recycle anything they can get hold of. They're building anything, doesn't matter what it is, bits and pieces. There was one city outside Lusaka, which is built entirely of 44-gallon drums. They beat the drums out flat, and they use the lids, which they cut off, as tiles for the roof. It's absolutely amazing. Miles and miles of it. And now, of course, there are no drums left, so they don't do it anymore. But it was all metal, the whole city. So it's almost the material and the method and the technology sort of comes afterwards. I mean, if you gave this land to a whole lot of Australians, what would they do with it? And they weren't allowed to own it. They weren't allowed to, there would have to be some rules. But this is what happens. And I don't know who makes the rules in these cities in Africa, but somebody does. Because there are streets, and they're given names. And this order established is quite extraordinary, without any planners, without any forethought. And then, in fact, what happened in Zambia a long time ago was that they decided, instead of knocking them down, and they were all illegal, because in Zambia, the most people, Lusaka expanded at a phenomenal rate. There's about 1,000 families a night arrived.